Жапше.
Та, нақуанет мүтігөт көйт ағой апопо. Кей кон ағонги? Баку, баку кайгет бақя.
There's going to be some sort of a race tomorrow. Across the river, finishing here where the chief will be standing. Their best swimmer, this fella, Rongi Ruru, starts right behind with a greenstone dagger in his mouth. If he catches up, he uses it.
But you can't swim.
I don't have to. It's not polite to make a god swim.
When he was in the Theatre Royal, they showed a lot of his films. And the first time, when they were tiny, the boys, I had the two younger ones with me. And Noel was killed. I think it was the Seekers. He got a spear through him. Well, of course, screams of horror, you know. I had to take them out.
They thought their daddy was dead.
They were very thought their daddy was dead, yes, yes.
Well, I'll be.
Get us out of these chains, will you?
After all you've got us into, you lying blathermouth. Get yourself out of it.
Come over, see.
I tell you for the last time, get away from us.
Will you get us through that hot head of yours that I didn't sell El Libre?
My dear sir, let me assure you.
You can see for ourselves what he's done. If we'd gone my way instead of yours, El Libre, I wouldn't be dead. Consuelo wouldn't be held captive in the palace. And we'd have had the guns to stop Bruno's men from crushing us.
Hold it, gentlemen. Soldiers.
By order of Baron Bruno, all fishing will be done under armed escort. The entire catch to be turned over to the governor.
But what will be left for us?
A bait.
In that case, we'll do no fishing.
Oh, right. Any more objections?
I'll never forget when he wrote to me, he said, when he stood outside, when he went to America, to Hollywood, and he stood outside and looked up at the MGM sign over the gates and thought of all the wonderful people that, and the wonderful films that had come from that studio. You know, he really... He was very moved by the whole thing.
You go to Tahiti with Mutiny on the Bounty, and you meet the nicest American people, and you meet the nicest of English people. And that was where I first met Marlon Brando, who happens to be a great pal of mine.
Begging your pardon, sir. Are we really making for the Horn?
Yes, evidently.
May heaven protect us. I was in Admiral Anson's ship, sir.
Were you really? Do you find it interesting?
Interesting, sir? It was like riding a cork over a waterfall, sir. And wind is not the name for what blows in your face. It's something made of iron. Swings at you from the west. Never changing, day in and day out. With seas as high as the mainmast. We had lifelines rigged everywhere, sir, and there were still 16 men washed overboard. Cold. Three men frozen the yards. Frozen stiff, sir. Couldn't get them down without cutting their fingers loose from the shrouds. I was lucky. But that's the Horn for you, sir. A delightful passage.
I knew him very well, and now Harris I know very well. They were doing the remake of Mutiny on the Bounty. And Harris was under a... He'd just become big after a sporting life, and they said to him, this will be over in 10 weeks. It's a short shoot, 13 weeks tops, and we were there for 13 months. And Harris was going mental, and it was Marlon Brando was holding the whole thing up every day. And they were literally at it. Marlon Brando and Harris would be fighting and pushing. And so Purcell was sent down to break up a row one day, one Irishman to another Irishman, you know. And he pulled the two of them apart because he was big. big lad. And he pulled the two of them apart. And he said, well, do you two fellas ever get a bit of sense? Sure, aren't we all only working men? And when he told us that, he'd say, and Madeline looked at me, and then Dickie looked at me, and the two of them had a good laugh, and we got on with the job for that day. We did a revival of that and down in Goffs, Kildare, and I asked him would he play Jacob, and I just said to him, you know, there's no kind of hint here that you're as old as Jacob, but you're perfect for the part, and he did it. And he used to keep going on about his pins, you know, his legs, and the old pins mightn't be up to it every night. And he says, I hope there's no dancing and with those giggles, and because he just opened the show, but he was terrific. You know. He was. And every night after the bar, the show was a short show, it'd come down to 10:05. We often didn't leave there till 12:30, him just regaling us with stories about this fella and that fella and this film, and because we were all just gobsmacked. I feel a strange, it's touching thing about to be.
Noel, didn't you bring himself and Cecil Sheridan together for a show as well?
Yeah, there was a bicentenary show of the American bicentenary we did in 76. And they did this song, the Walter Houston song, from May to September. And Earl Gill was the conductor. And he'd be vamping away in the pit. And the two boys would be telling gags to each other nearly before they start, you know. And Earl would just keep the baton going. In your own time, boys, in your own time, boys, you know. And quite often the two of them started in different keys, you know.
Really?
So then we used to stop it and they'd start themselves. So, and it was a very moving song. Like when they got going, it was really, really moving song. Because the two of them were at an age where they were reflecting on their own lives, you know. And they would never, ever go to perform again together, you know. So a couple of months later, there was a show out in RTE, and Earl was the conductor as well, and there was a cabaret show, and Purcell was, Noel was doing it, and he said, I'll do the September song. And Earl said, where's your dots? And he said, what do you mean, the dots? He said, the dots are up here, son, you know? So he said, and another thing, he says, I don't have that other fellow with me who kept upsetting me all the time in the gaiety, Earl, so carry on. Earl starts off, music, once, twice, three. No, whenever you're ready, we'll follow you. You know? He was great.
Hey, will we chance it? Well, we'll chance it again for old time's sake. Try to remember the kind of September when life was slow and all so mellow. Try to remember the kind of September when grass was green and the grain was yellow. Try to remember the kind of September when you were tender and callow. Try to remember, and if you remember, then follow. For deep in December, it's nice to remember, although you know the snow will follow. Deep in December, it's nice to remember without a hurt. The heart is hollow. Deep in December, it's nice to remember the fire of September that made us mellow. Deep in December, it's nice to remember. And a follow.
No matter where he was, he tried to get Mass on Sunday. One time they were in Tahiti. He discovered that the only little church close to where they were working was through a jungle, and there was only one old French priest there. So Mass was about to start, but there was no altar boy. So Noel served the Mass. And, for that time, yeah.
Very tall altar boy.
Very tall, 6'4" altar boy.
And didn't he have this little saying that he kept in his pocket about going past the church?
That's true. He said, whenever I am near a church, I go in for a visit, so that when I'm carried in, the Lord won't say, who is it?
To sleep in the hay.
You see, Mary and Joseph had just come all the way from Nazareth to Bethlehem. And it was very late and they'd come.
But if Mary knew she was going to have a baby, why did she go on such a long journey?
Well, that's a very good question. Well, you see, the king, he's a bit of a bowsy, this king. So foul, eh? And he'd ordered everybody to get back to where they were born, so that they could be counted, so that they could pay tax.
I thought that was one of the greatest pieces of television I've ever seen. He made religion simple and beautiful, and he involved you in his terminology as only he could. And I remember sitting down, and I was quite moved by the way he did it. He was sat in the chair as I'm doing now. And then he started off saying, well, you know, it happened in Bethlehem a long time ago, as you know, and there was things were tough, things were hard, you know, he couldn't get a job or anything, even Joseph couldn't get anything to get. And I thought, my God, isn't this incredible? How all the children will go around the television set, because he had that aura, that ambience about him, and they would love to hear him tell the story about Jesus, but as a grandfather figure, maybe. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And he moved me, and I'm sure he moved everybody.
For his centenary, the Dublin Civic Museum has gathered together memorabilia from Noel's life. An early honour, This Is Your Life with Eamon Andrews in 1958. And also including what was for Noel a high point, the honour of being made a free man of his native Dublin.
He was like a child that day. It was a great honour, you see, because there'd been only about one every 2 or 3 years, and the name in the book immediately, foreign book, was the Pope, Pope John Paul. Noel had to sign after that. But the Mansion House was packed, and we walked down the centre aisle. Maureen Potter, of course, was given the freedom the same day, and Noel wasn't in the best of physical form, so I had to wheel him in a wheelchair and help him up the stairs then. And he sat on the stage, and of course the stage was resplendent. The councillors were there in the robes, and the firemen were there with the mace and the sword, the ancient mace and sword, and the Lord Mayor's chair brought specially over from the council chamber. And the Corporation Choir sang Dublin Can Be Heaven, and of course Noel loved that. And being the real sort of trooper, he was waving the arms around and conducting and singing with them, and I think he enjoyed it immensely.
Wonderful honour, you know. I think they were the first two actors ever to be given the freedom of the city.
Oh, God, if I was only 83 again. Merciful. Friends? Romans? Countrymen? That's not me, Prefer Q. It's me own darling Dubliners that I am talking to. Friends old and new, all tried and true, who've honored me this day. It makes me feel so humble, but this I'd like to say. If some kind fairy moved her wand and offered me the earth, I'd rather be a free man in the city of my birth.
Great honour.
And then quite shortly after that, Eileen, Noel was very ill in hospital.
That's true, yes, yes. He hadn't been too well, you know, but of course he never complained, and so eventually he had to go into hospital, and of course they were delighted in hospital because he kept them all the patients were very quiet and listening to Noel telling stories and everything in there.
Ah, sir. How are you?
Don't. I heard you wanted an old state practitioner. How are you? Great to see you.
Thank you for coming.
Not at all. And you're 81.
Oh, thank you, sir. Indeed.
You know very well he owns the farm, but we'll be out of the town. And you get up out of that ship with a rat. Mr. McGuire,
get down! The first thing I said, look at you. You'd do anything to get your name in the paper. You really will, honest to God.
And I think Hal it was who said before we went in, listen, the only way we're going to get through this is make a gag. Don't be somber about this, don't be sad and so on. So you bolstered yourself up and made a few gags, and he tried to make a few gags, but quite clearly he was near the end. He was still this massive figure in the bed, but he was failing fairly rapidly, and he knew it, and everybody around the place knew it. And so we said goodbye, or we'd be in next week, or whatever you say on these occasions. I don't know how one is expected to handle these occasions, but we all knew what we were talking about and what we meant. And we came out, and Hal and I recollect I had a few words, but I think a few tears were shed because we were saying goodbye to a legend, an absolute legend.
We'd had such a wonderful life. Oh, I was heartbroken, of course, and I miss him to this day, you know. But he was great through it all. He never complained, and just he went away. I was sitting beside him holding his hand. And so the nurse called for some, you know, said something at the next cube. He wouldn't go into a private room. He stayed in, he was in a cubicle. And somebody in the next cubicle called the nurse, sister, the nurse. And I turned over to see what it was. And he just closed his eyes and was gone when I looked back. Yeah, I was holding his hand. Just like that.
Hundreds of people from all walks of life, including the theatre, music, entertainment and politics, turned up to pay their last respects to theatre veteran Noel Purcell, and the Star of the Sea Church in Sandymount was filled to capacity. Actors from the stage and screen, as well as colleagues from the olden days of the Theatre Royal, the Queen's and the Capitol, came along to the graveside.
My last connection, I suppose, with Noel was when he died, the Lord Mayor of the day, who was Michael O'Halloran, and myself, went along to Eileen, his widow, to his house, and we gave her a Dublin flag. We felt it was appropriate that this free man of Dublin, who had occupied such a big part in the hearts of so many Dubliners, should have the Dublin flag on his coffin. And we gave it to Eileen for that purpose.
And I suppose there's going to be a fair amount of people who say it's a fair amount of mush, but there's a certain amount of sentiment in it that I believe in. Thanks for the memory of stars who play the Royal, Frankie Blowers, Freddie Doyle, Jimmy Campbell's band with his carnation and his style. Thank you, Jim, so much. And thanks for the memory of 1952, the film and review, 3 hours entertainment, matinee, a bob to you. And thank you so much, Peggy, Pauline, Noel, and Eddie, Dickie Forbes, brilliant pen at the ready, Royalettes with precision so steady, Alison Babs, Paradise perhaps, and thanks for the memory. I'll be judged when day is done, when St. Peter says, "Owl son, parcel washes whiter, but I can't swap two for one. I'll say thank you." So.
And he never kind of upstaged anybody intentionally, although, you know, the most famous upstaging story, he was a big opera buff, and he loved, and I don't know what Tosca was at the Gaiety, and he couldn't get in, it was genuinely booked out, and Joe Kearns did everything to get him in. He said, "No," he said, "I'll stand, I'll sit on the steps, I'll sit on the wings." He said, "No, you can't." So, whatever they call it, opera spear carry. So he went in the crowd scene, and he was so tall, he towered over everybody and the extras. And this poor French or Spanish or whatever, Italian tenor, was doing, did his nut. And the crowd erupted. And Ernie went, "What's going on?" Porcel was behind your man going. And after a while, he said he knew it wasn't the singing. And he looked around and he saw Porcel put the hat down and walked on as the bishop off stage, you know. He was great.
Dublin country heaven, country has a heaven. Whatever fate may send, here my roots are deep in friendly soil. Dublin can be heaven, with coffee and a lemon, and a stroll down Taylor Street. There's no need to worry, there's no need to worry, for a king and a lady's a queen.
Grafton Street's a wonderland. There's magic in the air. There are diamonds in the lady's eyes and gold dust in her hair. And if you don't believe me, come and meet me there in Dublin on a sunny summer morning. That's about all I can do. I'm back. We wish you, I'm sure, a very, very happy Christmas and a peaceful New Year.
At 10 p.m. on Christmas Day, relive some classic candid comedy moments with Mike Murphy.
I got a bus up here.
That there is a Pat Kenny, is it?
I'll get your cream on it. I'm the house.
Will you?
Yeah. Oh, you can
give a hatch. Mike's Christmas Crackers, 10 p.m. Christmas Day on RTE1.
Worth £8,000 for the list wife. It's 32,000. You better say thank you to the audience.
Yes, 64,000. It's the most successful game show in the world. Who wants to be a millionaire? St. Stephen's Day at 8 o'clock and 9 o'clock on RTE1.
This Christmas, why not follow Santa's lead? Get down to Supervalue and look out for more unbelievable savings throughout the store. Fresh yellow honeydew melons, now just 89p each. You save a fantastic 90p. Juicy clementines, 1.5 kilo net, now only 169. You save 99p. And Supervalue pale ham fillets, worth 5.39 each, now just 3.99. You save 140. Great value from Supervalue this Christmas. That's shopping as it should be.
The Scorpion is a new kind of power saw from Black & Decker. It works just like a handsaw, but with less effort. Cutting easily and precisely, with a push-button blade change system that lets you move on to the next job in no time. Whatever the job, the new Scorpion, the smarter way to saw, only from Black & Decker.
Only the Epson Stylus has a crystal printhead that gives you the pin's sharpest dots. And that means pretty impressive prints. Epson. See what you're missing.
So you were sick last week, were you?
But when David spoke to you on Friday afternoon, you seemed all right.
Lemsip Max Strength. Next time you're ill, you try it.
Now there's 21 Nightlinks serving the suburbs, 5 times a night, Monday to Saturday, and twice on Sunday, so you can get picked up 7 nights a week.
Someone very special closer this Christmas.
Hello.
Aircom, go further.
The National Concert Hall on January the 7th. Christmas in Fair City. Happy Christmas, Harry.
Happy Christmas.
I'll pass on the kissing if you don't mind.
Next year we'll have a little bit to buy presents for.
It'd be great, won't it? So, do you like kids?
Well, I don't know. I've never had a full one.
It's a new business plan. I'm looking over the figures.
When?
Past few days.
Oh, for God's sake, can you not get Christmas over us first?
Our first Christmas together, Paul. I just want us to enjoy it.
Festive drama in Fair City. Christmas Day at 9.35 and St. Stephen's Day at 8.30 on RTE1. The winner of 11 Academy Awards.
Titanic was called the Ship of Dreams. I can still smell the fresh paint.
The most successful movie of all time.
Iceberg, right ahead!
The best picture of the year.
1,500 people went into the sea.
The network TV premiere.
God almighty.
Titanic, Christmas Day at 5.15 on RTE1.
The Titanic tale continues over on 2. This time it's the story of the White Star Line building. We're leaping through 100 years is in an hour. Now on one, Lily's efforts to bring her family closer to...